First, let's invite Professor Chung from Baptist University Continuing Education College to deliver a welcome speech. Let's welcome Dean of HKBU, SEE, Professor Chung, to deliver a welcome speech. Professor Chung, please. Thank you, Raymond and Siron, our two CLAPTEC students. Mr. Patrick Chung, Enterprise Strategy and Talents Transformation Lead of IBM. Dr. Lucas Hui, Chief Technology Officer and Acting CEO of S3. Mr. Vincent Kwok and Ms. Eva Kwok, Directors of Talent Cultivation of Hong Kong Computer Society. Mr. Danny Leung, Senior IT Manager, Advanced Technology Town Gas. Mr. Stanley Yu, Executive Director of Group Technology, UBS. Mr. Fred Xu, National Technology Officer, Microsoft. Mr. Eric Hui, Director, Business Development, IoT Ecosystems, Asia Pacific of Equinix. Industry friends, mentors, secondary school heads, teachers, and students, good afternoon. I'm very honored to be here at this webinar. Today, this is the Smart City webinar. And at the end of February, we had a mentorship scheme kickstart ceremony in the industry. And after that, we are happy to meet with you again. On behalf of the Baptist University, SCE, I would like to thank CLAPTEC Pathway and the six partners for the active participation, including IBM, S3, Town Gas, UBS Group, Microsoft, and Equinix, and also the support of the Hong Kong Computer Society. This webinar can be organized successfully. Well, actually, various participating organizations have prepared very rich content. And on different topics, we are going to share with you the experience in the industry. I want to also thank Hong Kong Jockey Club Charities Trust for their sponsor donation and support. CLAPTEC Pathway students often hear that in the future, there is the need for many talents who know new technology and soft skills, especially in a number of areas, for example, data analytics, cybersecurity, cloud computing. And sometimes some students may think that these are very important concepts, but they seem to be rather vague and misty. So if there can be more down-to-earth discussions and concrete examples, then students will be better able to understand the main points. I believe that in relation to these hot topics in the coming months or years, you may have some new ideas, understanding, and there may be some new developments. And today, we hope that various sectors, teachers, students, and industry friends can have better understanding of how the government and the industry are implementing and pushing forth the plan so that smart city can be realized. So this webinar is for the sake of this topic. Students and various participants can understand more about the government's smart city blueprint. So that is our core topic. So within a short period of time, we hope that you will have better understanding about smart government, environment, citizens, economy, mobility, and life. Now, today we have six different sector partners with us here. They will share with us a lot of their insights and experience. This is an invaluable opportunity. I hope students will listen very attentively. And please think of how your knowledge and skills can help you in the future, so that we can shape the smart city together. And please also think of how you can enhance your own knowledge and skills, and at the same time, you can also seize opportunities in relation to future development online. So we hope to get more understanding and knowledge. In the latter part of the webinar, students can have some exchanges with guests from different sectors, so you can understand more about their positions, and please seize the opportunities to ask questions. So in the future, you will have more confidence in joining any of these sectors. Once again, on behalf of CLAPTECH Pathway, welcome you all to today's webinar, and I hope you will gain a lot. Thank you very much. So this is the second academic year of CLAPTECH Pathway. I believe many students are thinking of their future pathway. IT is advancing fast, and we need to keep up with time in order to maintain competitiveness. Now, let's invite Mr. Vincent Kwok, Director of Talent Cultivation of Hong Kong Computer Society, to talk about the IT career and future trends. I believe many classmates like me are wondering the future pathway. There is rapid progress in technology, so as the future IT professionals, we should constantly be learning and relearning. Now, may we invite Mr. Vincent Kwok, Director of Talent Cultivation of Hong Kong Computer Society, to introduce career in IT and future trends. Mr. Kwok, please.
Thank you.
Thank you, MC, Zyron and Raymond. Greetings, Professor Chong, students, secondary school heads, teachers, industry friends, greetings. Good afternoon. Now, today, I would like to take this opportunity to talk about coming IT trends and also things we need to pay attention to concerning our career. As Professor Chong said, there are different innovative technologies which are advancing every day. What opportunities do they bring to us? I would like to take this opportunity today to do some sharing. I am working on talent training in the Hong Kong Computer Society, and my team focuses on employment opportunities and positions in Hong Kong that are popular. If we want to take up those positions, what necessary qualifications do we need? As Professor Chong said, later on, there are professionals and experts in different sectors to talk about development direction. So I will set a simple platform here. So nowadays in Hong Kong, what kind of industries or sectors or positions are, more in demand? So students can think of the subjects that they want to choose so as to have better development opportunities in the future. So let me share with you our researchers. I believe you will be able to see the screen here. This is the first slide. Last year, we did some researches. On the left, you can see some popular job categories. And on the right, you can see positions or sectors that need IT skills. So on the left, you can see, for example, innovative technology, IT software development, things related to development. So you can imagine that technology is changing fast. Every day, there are new apps coming up. So the demand is very big, more than 50% of the market demand. And then on the right, which sectors are more popular? It's not difficult to imagine. Hong Kong is a financial center. So financial industry and the banking industry have more demands. So if you talk about popular industry categories, they will be IT sectors, developing IT sectors, and mainly in the finance industry. So students will be able to tell from these charts which industries are more demand, more popular. And then, Is it true that technical skills are the most important? Technical skills are important. If we work on IT, we need to have a certain professional knowledge, for example, programming, technical skills. Apart from technology, another thing that is very important is domain knowledge. What is domain knowledge? That is knowledge about the industry. So as you can see from the previous two pie charts, on the left, you can see that technology is important, but industry is also important. Professor Chung just said we need to apply our knowledge in our daily life. We always talk about virtual banking, online banking. Now, when it comes to online banking, is it true that we can just use existing technology in online banking? Well, definitely not only that. We need to have related domain knowledge. For example, if we want to do online banking, we may need to know that there are many applications. For example, mortgage, savings, account opening. These are domain knowledge. So when students prepare for future career, they need to have hard skills, for example, technology knowledge, programming, integration work. At the same time, students need business knowledge and domain knowledge. They need to know how to apply technology. Apply technology, that's the essence. This is a very simple chart. So in different industries, there are different positions. And some positions are in bigger demand. More people are working in those sectors. So later on, I can share more with you. It's for your reference. After joining an industry, for example, an IT industry, then how can we continue our development in the IT industry? Now on the left, you can see this ladder. So in the past, you were in primary school, then later on, secondary school and university. It's a ladder. So on the left, you can see IT trainee. You will pick up some basic knowledge and then analyst, project manager, and then all the way to director. And you need to have certain necessary conditions, as Professor Chung said. In the industry, the hottest topics are big data analysis. On the right, you can see data scientist. So some students in the future may want to be scientists. In the past, scientists might be chemical scientists or physical scientists, mechanical scientists. But now there is a new type of scientist, data scientist. So how do we use data to analyze, to see what is needed most in the market? For example, nowadays, students use a lot of social media or IG, and there is a lot of data science involved there. So people want to know what users are most interested in, then this is to facilitate advertising and demand generation. So much of the internet is being used. So another hot topic is cybersecurity. Many companies in the banking and finance industry or retail banking need a lot of these talents, and then artificial intelligence. So we want things to be automated or mechanized. So that's AI. And then fintech. Fintech is a new technology. Later on, perhaps our speakers will talk more about that. Apart from hard skills, soft skills are also important. What are soft skills? Soft skills include a lot of things. So it's about whether a person can do self-management. Do we have discipline? Are we responsive or responsible? How do we manage time? These are important. When we work in society, well, sometimes students or university students ask me, Vincent, if I go for a job interview, what should I pay attention to? What will employers look for? So usually people will assess whether students can do self-management. Is their time management good? Do they have problem-solving skills or communication skills? Can they be effective in discussing a problem with others? How do they analyze problems? How do they solve problems? These are important soft skills. And then, of course, teamwork is important. When we work in society or in school, sometimes we will work with others in projects, and we need teamwork spirit. How do we work as a team to solve problems together? Apart from solving problems, we need to set expectations for the management and for staff. So all these are soft skills. So in the market, of course, IT in the market is in bigger and bigger demand, and we also need students to have strong soft skills, teamwork soft skills, and also independent time management skills. These are very important knowledge, and you can prepare yourself better with these, no matter whether you will further your study or whether you will work. So this is some simple information that I'm sharing with you. Now I'm going to spend 2 minutes on the computer society. Now, we are celebrating the 50th anniversary this year, and we have around 10,000 members. So through this society's platform, members will communicate and contact each other, and they will communicate and update each other on IT knowledge. And then a good interpersonal network can be built. This is important to people's career. And there are different groups in the society. And the team that I am responsible for is talent communication or talent cultivation. There are altogether 5 groups. Talent cultivation group is responsible for talent training in schools and also among those who are employed. We also offer career assistance and industry engagement. All these can be provided by the Computer Society to students. And if you are interested in the future, please feel free to join us. We have associate programs. Even if you are still in university, you can join us to enhance your knowledge about the industry. So that's all from me today. So later on, if you have questions, please feel free to communicate. Thank you once again. Thank you, Mr. Kwok, for your sharing. Since 2017, Hong Kong had announced the Hong Kong Smart City Blueprint. In 6 different smart areas, there are different measures to make use of innovative technology to improve people's lives and to improve city management. Now we will invite our 6 CLAPTECH Pathway partners to do more sharing. In 2017, the government has published the Smart City Blueprint for Hong Kong, setting out an array of initiatives under 6 smart areas. Now we are honored to invite our industry partners to expound and share each of the areas. Now may we first invite Mr. Patrick Chang, Enterprise Strategy and Talent Transformation Lead of IBM, to share the topic of smart government. Mr. Chang, please. Now may we first invite Mr. Patrick Chang, Enterprise Strategy and Talent Transformation Lead of IBM, to share the topic of smart government. Mr. Chang, please. Good afternoon, Vincent. Can you first unshare your screen so that I can share my screen?
Thank you.
Thank you. Can you please give me a moment?
Oh,
Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Patrick Zhang from IBM. Today, I'm happy to do this sharing with you about smart government. What is smart government? Within the smart city blueprint, there are different pillars. And one of the important areas is smart government. The definition of smart government in Hong Kong is what? Well, it is to use intelligence or smart ways to offer more user-friendly public services for citizens, for organizations and society. We want to be smarter and more user-friendly. So we need to be able to make use of different data. Very often, you will hear the use of open data, public data and private data can be integrated, and then the data can be analyzed. We need some infrastructure in order to analyze the data. So apart from open data within smart government, there is also infrastructure. For example, BIM, Building Information Model, that is for construction and architecture related data, and then common spatial data or common spatial data infrastructure. Apart from open data and infrastructure, one important thing is how the government makes use of such technology. Government departments have different work processes. No matter whether they are facing citizens and organizations, different technologies are being adopted in the processes all along. So how do they use data? And how can the infrastructure enable data analytics and data integration? And as a result, there will be actionable insights. We can give advice to stakeholders so that they can make decisions more effectively. Now, let me share with you how different governments outside of Hong Kong can make use of open data or even artificial intelligence technology. The first example is education. How do we use data to enable students to enjoy more effective education? This is a US example. How is data used to analyze each student's growth? For example, a student's score in a certain subject is 50. Now, this is a failure grade or mark, and we need teachers to analyze the reasons behind this 50 mark. Is it because a student is not familiar with a certain subject or topic, or is it true that the foundation is not good enough? There are things that the student doesn't understand. So we are talking about different measurements in education. Then we will know what a student needs so that he can learn more. And then there can be personalized learning. A student may not know certain topics, so those need to be deepened. But then for student B, he may have other areas that he needs more deepening. So we can use data to analyze students' learning, and then in the future, when these students seek employment, they can also get help. And then the second example is healthcare. A patient's medical records or family history need to be looked at. When students, when doctors come up with diagnosis or prescription, and then post-care also is one important factor. This is an interesting example. This is a Japanese university. So they use data to analyze the DNA structure of each patient. And as a result, various cases are looked at together. And then based on the DNA data and medical records, a personalized cancer treatment can be offered so that we don't need to seek many doctors' opinions. This data integration is already covering more than 1 million data points so that there can be a more effective, more helpful recovery or rehabilitation treatment. And then tax and revenue or public service. In Hong Kong, we have 7 odd million people. Every working person needs to file tax returns in order to make sure that there won't be fraud case. Well, a lot of manpower needs to get involved to do investigation. How can we use data to analyze and to let people know that certain cases may be prone to fraud, and then more human power or manpower can be focused on the vulnerable cases. In this way, the speed of investigation can be enhanced. The last example, social. This is also an American case. Data is used to identify criminal pattern among the juvenile people. So based on different data and profile, upbringing can be assessed. So there will be structured and unstructured data. So for example, sentencing, probation program, or different methods can be adopted to help these people to achieve better rehabilitation. Some youths may be subject to that kind of pattern. So a probation pattern may be most effective. Then the judge will be more inclined to come up with a better judgment. Apart from the above four examples, education, healthcare, tax and financial, and social, a government department can use data to be more efficient and make better informed decisions. In government departments, there are also other opportunities to leverage open data. For instance, energy, security, environment, trade, and so on. These are different areas in which the government can use data. So that's all about smart city in government, in Hong Kong government. So how do other countries use data and artificial intelligence? Ultimately, in the future, no matter what positions you will take up in the future, I hope you will remember that concerning the use of data, data ethics and AI ethics is the most important. We want to use data and AI to help different stakeholders to improve the situation. And at the same time, well, while there are these social or commercial benefits, at the same time, we need to make sure human well-being. So we need to use data ethically and most effectively. This is the most important. And when it comes to use or protection of data, it is not only the job of IT practitioners. Actually, from the top to bottom of an organization, every colleague needs to pay attention to ethical use of AI, because data, AI in our daily lives can help us a lot. And at the same time, we need to have trust in AI. And how do we build trust? There are a few points here. Number one, in the use of data and AI, we first need to be clear about its positioning and functions. It is not to replace human beings. It is there to assist us to make better decisions. The data or the insights derived should be owned by the data holders. And number three, no matter what data we use, there must be transparency. And we must be able to explain to the stakeholders about the algorithm and the logic behind, so that we can make sure that things are fair and equal and just. Apart from transparency and clear explanation, it is also important to be robust. Robustness means that we need to be proactive in protecting the data so as to make sure that there won't be external invasion or attack or malicious use of the data. So protection of data is important. Before I close today, I hope that you will understand how a government can use data. And students, in the future, when you work in society, when you think of how to use data, I hope you will remember that apart from using the data, we need to actually use the data ethically. So that's all from me today. Back to the MC, please. Thank you, Mr. Zhang. Now may we invite Mr. Danny Leung, Senior IT Manager, Advanced Technology Town Gas, to share the topic of smart environment. Mr. Leung, please. Now may we invite Mr. Danny Leung, Senior IT Manager, Advanced Technology Town Gas, to share the topic of smart environment. Mr. Leung, please. Good afternoon. Today, my topic is smart city, smart environment. So regarding smart environment, what are the goals of the government? I believe students have done some homework, so I will not explain in great detail. But these are my four highlights. Better indoor and outdoor air quality, greener buildings, how to use technology, and reduce daily waste. The government has introduced five initiatives. First, Climate Action Plan. By 2030, the government would like to reduce carbon, and carbon intensity should be reduced by 65% to 70%. And there should be more green buildings and higher energy efficiency. Waste management should be improved. Pollution monitoring should also be improved. So when it comes to pollution, it is not only about waste or garbage. It is also noise pollution, light pollution, and so on. And finally, environmental hygiene. Now the government is looking at two things. The first thing is environmental hygiene in public toilets, and number two, work in relation to bugs or rats and so on. So Town Gas has a history of 159 years and we are a corporate citizen. So how can we support these initiatives? Two parts. First, in our business, you know that we burn gas in Town Gas. And you may think of whether a lot of bad gases will be emitted. I can tell you that even though the name of our company is Town Gas, we do not use town gas as fuel. We use naphtha. So we started to use naphtha in the 70s. So we do not use coal. We use this kind of byproduct from oil, but is this enough? Actually, in the 90s, we brought in other gases as our feedstock, including natural gas and methane. So on this chart, you can see that naphtha only accounts for 38% now, natural gas 61%, landfill gas 1%. So you can see that natural gas accounts for a high share because it can reduce carbon and it is more efficient. With this combination, we are able to reduce CO2 emission. So there's only 0.597 kilogram of carbon dioxide emission per unit of town gas. Comparing with 2005, we are down 22% in terms of carbon emission. So my data was dated 2019 because we still don't have the 2020 data. But then actually, I think we are only at 25 to 30%. So that's about our feedstock. Just now, you saw that landfill gas accounted for 1%. In New Territories Northeast, we have a landfill project. It actually started operation in 2007, that plant. And inside that plant, we collected landfill gas and we process it. And we have laid a 19 kilometer long pipeline. So it is 19 kilometer long. Is it very long? Not really. But if you need to lay a 19 kilometer long path pipeline, you need to do a lot of work in the environment. So it is a rather big scale. This project can help us reduce 135,000 tons of carbon emission every year. In Changkwan O, we have another landfill gas collection project. And this that started in 2017, and there's a 12 kilometer long pipeline, which is connected to our town gas disbursement or distribution station. And it helps cutting 56,000 tons of CO2 emission every year. So we have done some work in terms of gas. What about waste management? In 2003, we started to help our customers to recycle some used kitchen appliances. Materials of these used appliances will be recycled. We may sell them to recyclers. Every year, we recover 1,600 tons. And then the proceeds do not go to our profit. The proceeds are used to develop environmental projects within our company. Okay, so much about our company and also environmental protection work. How can IT support these initiatives? First, well, the first example I would like to talk about is our data center. We have our own data center. In our headquarters, the building itself is a BEAM Plus certified building. BEAM Plus is an environmental certification. So some specifications have to be met in terms of water usage, power usage, and so on. And the area of our data center is 380 square meters, around 4,000 square feet. And we have more than 400 servers and other storage facilities. And it operates around the clock. That means we consume a lot of energy to operate the data center. In 2007, the data center was renovated. At that time, we brought in some new environment protection concepts. In the past, our data center was close to the facade of the building. However, in this way, the facade would be heated and the temperature of the data center would be affected. So we moved the data center away from the facade. So here in this picture, you can see that on the ceiling, there are some yellow cable trays. So optic fibers, computer cables are put there. In the past, those ran underground on the raised floor. However, the bad point about that is that air ventilation, airflow will be obstructed. And the airflow efficiency of the data center would be affected. Energy efficiency would also be affected as a result. So in 2007, we replanned it. So on this slide on the left, you can see that these are what we call cold aisle and hot aisle divide. So in some aisles, we emit cold air, and some aisles, hot air will be collected. So this can enhance operation of data center, because in data center, air conditioning system consumes most energy. So how do we do the calculation? We use PUE, power usage efficiency. So that's the total energy consumption of the data center divided by IT equipment power, like server, disk storage, network equipment. And then the result is the efficiency. So on this slide, you can see that if we are at one, then that is very good. That means there is no overhead. The numbers after the decimal place is your overhead. And if you are at 1.2, that may be related to the geographical environment. So if you are in a cold place, then you will reduce the use of air conditioning, then you will be at 1.2. Today, in our data center, we are at 1.4. So that is classified as efficient. But are we already happy with that? Not necessarily. From time to time, we revisit it to see how we can improve our data center so that it is more efficient. Another example is our town gas bill. In 2004, we started to do bi-monthly billing. And if the total charges is less than $150, it will be carried forward onto the next bill. So in other words, by doing bi-monthly billing, we will save a lot of paper consumption. We will reduce paper wastage. In the past, we issued 12 bills in a year, and now only 6. So in this way, we can reduce 610 tons of carbon emission. And then there's another project which IT is promoting, and that is e-billing. So for e-billing, you can see that if a customer accepts e-billing, then 316 gram of carbon emission can be saved. You may say that 316 gram is very small, but the total will be huge. Right now, we have 200,000 e-bill customers. So around 1/10 of our total customers. So we are promoting the use of e-billing. In the past, people used town gas bills as address proofs. I think this will change in the future. So I hope that you can start to register e-bill. And students, please encourage your parents to change to e-bill. So even though we still need to print bills, we adopt environment-friendly measures. For example, our printer, it has ROHS certification. So in other words, less hazardous substances being used. 90-odd% of this printer can be recycled. And for the toner, it is environment-friendly toner as well. Then for our paper, we're using FSC certified paper, Forest Stewardship Council certified papers. And the certification process is very stringent. Yes, FSC certified paper is not 100% recyclable or recycled paper. However, well, they will evaluate how the forests are managed and whether there is serious felling of trees from where the papers come or arise. And then for the envelopes, the whole envelope is recyclable. And then let me remind you, very often you will see plastic sheets in envelope. Now for our plastic sheets, they are environment friendly. And when you dispose of the envelope, you should separate the envelope and the plastic sheet so that the envelope can be recyclable. So why is there this plastic sheet? Well, this is a technical issue. Without this plastic sheet, the bill may get into the corner of the envelope and then there may be paper jamming. So when you dispose of the envelope, please separate the envelope and the plastic sheet. All right. In 2016, we deployed more than 500 tablets to our frontline workers, so they can handle installation orders, maintenance orders, regular safety inspection orders, and emergency orders. Every year, 2.4 million order papers can be saved. And this is equivalent to 58 tons of carbon emission. So within such a short period of time, I tried my best to take you through our projects regarding smart environment. There are some forward-looking goals. For instance, green technology. In our company, we also adopt green technologies. For example, in mainland China, we collect kitchen waste and then we extract the oil and sell it to Europe. You may say that this is a gutter oil project, but it is also an environmental protection project because we can save carbon emission. Second, sustainability. To protect the environment, it is not a one-off effort. It has to be sustainable. So we need to use new technology. We are looking at IoT devices and the use of big data to help us improve. Finally, of course, we hope to reduce waste as much as possible and we hope to reuse and recycle. So that's all from me today. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Leung. Now, let's invite Mr. Fred Xu, National Technology Officer at Microsoft, to share the topic of smart people. Mr. Xu, please. Now, may we invite Mr. Fred Xu, National Technology Officer at Microsoft, to share the topic of smart people. Mr. Xu, please. Thank you, MCs. Professor Chong. Good afternoon, school heads, teachers in the CLAPTECH Pathway Project. Thank you, organizing committee, for inviting Microsoft to share with you about this interesting topic, smart people. Just now, students gave me feedback that the screen looks blurry. So perhaps in the future, you should consider other projects apart from Zoom. We also offer similar products for events. Smart City Blueprint, as Professor said, in 2017, at the end of 2017, the Hong Kong government introduced version 1. At the end of last year, version 2 was released. So Smart City Blueprint 2.0. So this blueprint has 6 areas: smart mobility, smart citizens, smart government, smart economy, smart environment, and smart living. The organizer is so clever. So all 6 companies, as partners of CLAPTECH Pathway, are invited to each talk about one area. So in the version 2.0, in the new version, there's also smart people, but now in fact there are 12 different initiatives. So I have downloaded some graphic information from the website. In the 12 different areas, half of them are related to talent development, and the other half are related to innovations and entrepreneurial spirit. Today, my topic is more about talent development. Just now, some speakers talked about smart government and smart environment, and those need different technologies and skills. And of course, there is also the need for talents. Otherwise, the development of smart city will lag behind. Then in relation to talents, technology keeps on developing. So now we are having Industrial Revolution 4.0. In Industrial Revolution, there's the need for human skills. And then in version 4.0, there's the need for digital skills and technical skills. Here you can see a lot of data. Some are dated 1 to 2 years ago. Some are latest data. If there is a skill gap, if the skills cannot catch up with social and economic needs, then there will be big loss. Many employers are of the view that many university graduates do not have the necessary skills. And a few years later, well, there may be work related to AI, big data, cloud computing, and there will be more and more positions related to those. As Vincent just said, in Hong Kong, there is an urgent need for those skills. Many employers and employees think that employees don't have the right skills. So in the age of digital transformation, there's the need for new skills and technology. And with COVID-19, I think COVID-19 has accelerated such transformation. In the past, some changes or innovations happened within 2 months, and now the whole pace was faster. McKinsey has published this report. In the past, in Industrial Revolution 2.0 or 3.0, usually manual skills, basic cognitive skills were needed. Now in digital transformation and also Industrial Revolution 4.0, the world needs more technical skills. Recently, we often work from home or we work and learn online. So social skills become more important in social and economic development. Now, every year, LinkedIn publishes economic graph. This may be a little bit outdated. Just now, Vincent said that in Hong Kong, skills needed are A, B, C, D, E, F, G. A is AI, B, blockchain, C, cloud computing, D, data analysis, E edtech, F fintech. And on LinkedIn graph, you can see the skills required by Hong Kong employees or Hong Kong employers. And here you can see growth rates and demand and number of people required. The number is bigger in AI and big data. Every 4 years, VTC does a manpower survey. So I think this is more quantitative. In 2018, you can see this trend as shown on the right. IT students, IT university students decreases in number. If this trend continues, that would be big impact on the overall economic development in Hong Kong. So the need for IT talents is on the rise. However, for students studying IT or STEM, well, the number decreases. So I think this is a worrying trend. I have asked many employees. 74% of the employees said in a Gartner survey in the US that they have not mastered the skills they need for their job today. So this is quite a big worry. Students, you may be learning a lot of things today and you may only start to work 5 or 10 years later. And things that you have learned by then will become outdated. So technology develops very fast. 5 years ago, nobody talked about AI. Now, a lot of people talk about AI. 10 years ago, no discussion about big data. Today, totally opposite. So we really need lifelong learning. That means you need to learn every day. Right now, you do not only learn from schools or universities. You can pick up a lot of information on the internet. Here you can see IBM fellow Thomas Bray. He said that businesses today care far less about someone's degree or underlying coursework and far more about whether they've been able to pass the necessary certification tests. This is important. Now, lifelong learning and also market certification, these are more important. In the coming 5 minutes, I would like to talk about future skills and what our contribution to Hong Kong is. Our mission is empowering every person and organization on the planet to achieve more. So in schools, we hope each student can use Microsoft technology and software to achieve more. In Hong Kong, we are the only vendor which has signed an MOU with the Education Bureau. We signed that long time ago. And it is in line with the Education Blueprint of Hong Kong. We offer education software to schools for use free of charge. At the same time, we have created a community so that teachers, schools, students, parents can learn the latest skills. So the most recent MAU is the fourth MAU, which covers a 5-year period. The latest one was since 2018. And then we have got a cooperation agreement so that students can use our technology to learn. And then we also work with different universities, including the Hong Kong Baptist University. Well, very often we sign MOU in virtual events. So we have different collaboration agreement with universities so that students can pick up the latest skill. They can get skill certification. We work with R&D departments of schools, and there are internship programs. Almost all universities have signed MOUs with us. Regarding secondary schools, in the past month or a few weeks ago, we started to work with some societies or organizations related to primary and secondary schools. Recently, we started an AI pilot school program, which is quite interesting. Teachers can get certification, students can also take our AI exams, and we offer programs to support them. And we also support the government's IT Innovation Lab program. And last week, together with ATO, we offer an AI for Good program. We want to use AI to enable society to support SDG, Sustainable Development Goal concept. So there are different programs for secondary schools and universities. I know that some pilot schools have taken part in these programs. Well, if your school is not in these programs, how can you learn Microsoft skills? Well, please visit our website. We have Microsoft Learn, and there is a path for students. Please click your role as student, and then there is a learning path that will tell you skills that you need to learn. There may be certification programs. So I won't play the video because my time is up. So with the Government Education Bureau, universities, and primary secondary schools, we also work with NGOs in the past week. There was the Autism Day under the UN, and we issued a press release to enable Murphy, a student with autism, to learn new skills, and we have helped him get a new job. He is happy to have learned Microsoft skills so that he's successful in landing a job. Please feel free to download the video for viewing. So that's all from me. Back to the MCs, please. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Xu. Next, let's invite Mr. Stanley Yu, Executive Director of Group Technology UBS, to share the topic of smart economy. Now, may we invite Mr. Stanley Yu, Executive Director of Group Technology UBS, to share the topic of smart economy. Mr. Yu, please.
Thank you, Zyron and Raymond.
Thank you, Zyron and Raymond. School principals, Professor Chung, teachers, students, greetings. Today, I'm going to share with you about smart economy. Let me share my screen. When it comes to smart economy, we need to consider Hong Kong's smart city development. 2 years ago, UBS published a report which analyzes different cities' leading position in smart city and work that has been done. Hong Kong as a smart city seems to have lagged behind global peers. 2 years ago, our position was number 18, comparing with London, New York, Singapore, and Seoul. We were behind them. So are we doing really badly? No, in fact, we are doing particularly well. Our development of smart city is not that fast because we're an early mover. Well, we already were very mature a long time ago. We are a modern city. Our technology is mature, so we have an early mover disadvantage. All our transport, traffic, and so on are very efficient. We are a very efficient city. Our finance, healthcare, legal system are all sound. Because of that, we don't have a strong motivation to change. Now we are going for long-term prosperity and stability. And our main focus is on real estate and finance sectors.
Uh,
our diversification and use of technology and innovation lacks motivation. Is this a big problem? No. The Hong Kong government has issued a smart city blueprint. We just have version 2.0, as many speakers mentioned. The Hong Kong government is clever. In smart economy, they first analyze Hong Kong's competitive advantages in terms of economy. A few years ago, our GDP exceeded 2 trillion. You may not be able to assess how big that number is, but then we can think of the composition. In Hong Kong, there are four main sectors leading the Hong Kong economy: trade and logistics, finance. Today, we will focus on that, professional services and tourism. For these different sectors, there are five different initiatives. On the right, you can see fintech, which we focus on, smart tourism, law tech, R&D, reindustrialization, and also in the legal system, we want to promote innovation and the new economy. Let me go through these five areas very briefly. Regarding fintech, I'm sure you are clear. Today, we have 8 virtual banks, 4 virtual insurance companies. We should feel happy. Hong Kong is just a small city, a weak market. Competition is so keen, but we already have so many virtual banks and virtual insurers. And then the Hong Kong MA is promoting open API so that different banks can share their business with technology companies through open API so that technology can be used to integrate banking services. And here you can see distributed ledger technology, DLT. I think this is going to be a big trend. Today, the Hong Kong government has already set up E-Trade Connect. So many companies in China and Hong Kong can use this platform for financing. We also have eMPF. So there is this eMPF platform for centralized management. So these are happening in Hong Kong in the fintech area. Let me turn to other initiatives. Then I will dig deeper into fintech, smart tourism. I don't know how much you know about Hong Kong's tourism industry. Some people said, Stanley, I fly to New Zealand to take a look at the shooting location of Lord of the Rings. Actually, in Hong Kong, tourism has a very important role. Many people overseas like the buildings and environments of Hong Kong. So if we can use technology to attract more people to travel in Hong Kong or to invest, then that is very important to our economy. So we have different tourist destinations, and people can look at these locations with AR. There is Discover Hong Kong. So through online platforms and technology platforms, the government promotes our tourism industry. And then law tech. We have online dispute resolution platform. And these are industrial-based developments. Besides, the government has done a lot of R&D subsidy work. So there are also tax incentives for technology companies. Very soon in Chang Kwan O, there's going to be a data technology hub and an advanced manufacturing center. So you can see that the government has done a lot of work in relation to infrastructure. So concerning taxation, and also legal management. There is also other work. Now, UBS in Hong Kong is an important financial institution. So let's talk about fintech. People may ask, Stanley, what is fintech? Is it true that a technology company is doing financial work? Not really. Fintech in our industry is a disruptor. It is going to reform the banking system. 27 years ago, this is what Bill Gates said. Banking is necessary, but banks are not. So we definitely need banking service. However, we may not need banks. 27 years ago, this is what he said. In the future, do we still rely on banks to promote banking service? That's a question mark. In the past 27 years, people began to feel the power and influence of fintech, and its influence is getting bigger and bigger. So what is fintech? If you are not sure, fintech represents financial technology. So these two words are abbreviated into fintech. So through technology and innovation, traditional banking services are provided for the public. So here you can see on the right, mortgage, bank transfer, wealth management, capital markets, insurance, payments. So we may be using PayMe and Alipay now, and then personal finance and RegTech, which is a new area, regulatory technology, and then blockchain, crypto, which is a very hot topic. You might have heard of Bitcoin, which is a very popular new currency. So all these areas can be categorized as fintech. How big is fintech? I can tell you that fintech has a huge market. Looking at the whole world, every year, resources put into fintech exceed 50 billion USD, almost 400 billion Hong Kong dollars. Every year, there are more than 500 new fintech companies set up. And right now, there are more than 2 billion of people using the phone to manage their finance. And most importantly, fintech is limitless. You can do a lot of wild things, and the barrier to entry is low. You only need 50 million to build a virtual bank. Of course, you need to comply with a lot of laws and regulations. You need technology. However, you can see that the barrier of entry is getting lower. And the trend is really huge. In the future, this is going to be a big leader. Now, for this fintech field, the potential is really huge. All banking financial customers become more and more tech savvy. They are no longer elders who don't know technology. Customers become more tech savvy. They ask for more personalized service. And people are so used to operating their phones. Besides, in the banking industry, we are talking about a globalized area. It is no longer by single market or single country. So you need to think of what you need to handle in fintech. So technology, I think there are a few technologies which you need to get some more understanding. AI, under AI, there are machine learning, natural language processing, and chatbot, so that human beings can talk to machines. And then big data, as Fred mentioned, Internet of Things. So all internet devices can be connected, DLT, distributed ledger technology, cryptocurrency, which is very popular, blockchain, NFT, non-fungible token. Now, many singers have paid attention to the use of NFT, smart contract, Ethereum, and Polkadot, which is newly launched. This is a new way, a new Ethereum-based platform for smart contract. And then we have cloud, 5G. So all these different technologies are available. Each technology can be used in fintech, and it is important in banking service. And finally, fintech is so big. How many fintech companies are there? Here, well, there are top 250 fintech companies. Many of them have not been heard by me. You may not know many of them. Of course, I hope that in the future, I will see a Hong Kong company which is actually established by some of you here. Then finally, to summarize, under smart economy, the most important thing is to be innovative. We need an innovative environment to attract external investors to Hong Kong to invest in innovation and technology. And our approach is digital transformation, particularly in fintech and reindustrialization. We hope to have a new innovation and technology ecosystem to attract more startups and investors. So finally, what you need to do is to become well-equipped so that you can tie in or you can rise together with this trend. The future world belongs to you. So be innovative and be technical. These are the final comments from me. That's all from me today. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Yu. Now, may we invite Dr. Lucas Ho, Chief Technology Officer and Acting CEO of Astree, to share the topic of smart mobility. Dr. Ho, please. Now, may we invite Dr. Lucas Ho, Chief Technology Officer and Acting CEO of Astree, to share the topic of smart mobility. Dr. Ho, please. Ladies and gentlemen, greetings. I'm Lucas Ho from Astree. Before I talk about smart mobility, please enjoy the following video. Hong Kong is moving into a new era of smart mobility. Internet of cars has changed the layout of traffic and transport. So cars, pedestrians, and infrastructure are effectively connected to enhance safety and efficiency of traffic and roads. This is the Internet of Cars technology developed by Hong Kong. So there is low latency, it is reliable, and there is seamless connection. Astree has introduced CV2X technology, and with the latest technology 5G CV2X, future smart mobility transport infrastructure development can be promoted. Among vehicles, they can talk to one another. They can receive static or dynamic infrastructure information, and through sensing, they can detect any dangerous elements on road. Astree is a pilot in development of Internet of Cars. And then with the support of government departments, Astree has introduced the biggest road testing scheme for this technology. From Science Park all the way to Sha Tin Town Center, there is the facility with a total length of 14 kilometers. The Astree team, together with working partners, work together, building the first road testing facility. and the related supporting facilities for Internet of Cars.
Roundabout vehicle incoming. Do not enter. Front collision warning. Front collision warning. Left blind spot vehicle coming. Left blind spot vehicle coming. Speed limit 50. Speed limit 50. Congestion ahead, please take right alternative route. Intersection alarm, front right vehicle coming. Found abnormal vehicle. Found abnormal vehicle. Found abnormal vehicle. Road work on the road ahead, please drive carefully.
迎科院致力在香港推动。Astri strives hard to promote smart mobility in Hong Kong. We want to make more contribution to our society with technology. Astri. So after watching this video, you will know what Astri is doing in terms of smart mobility. When it comes to smart mobility, it is one of the six areas in the Smart City Blueprint. If you only look at this area, it may only be about how cars can become smarter, but it is not only that. It is related to all smart city technologies. Let me talk about what Astri does. Astri is Hong Kong's largest applied technology R&D center created by the government. It studies different areas. Altogether, there are 500 odd people, R&D people. And there are also 100 odd other practitioners. Some are on business, some are working on other areas. So actually, R&D is very important. At the same time, soft skills are important. Soft skills are also needed. So within the past 20 years, there are more than 750 projects being implemented. So some are already launched in the market, and we have got more than 850 patents. We have five core initiatives: fintech, smart city, health technologies, industrialization, IC design. Smart city is the biggest area. So now, let me talk about smart mobility in Hong Kong. Smart mobility is one out of the six areas in Hong Kong Smart City Blueprint 2.0. So there are two main technologies. One, V2X. It is a communication system. Different cars can communicate with each other, and cars can communicate with the external world. Besides, how can cars operate smartly? The first thing is about connection among cars, and the second thing is to make cars smarter. The two together is about the long term. That is, how can we connect our smart vehicles? Now here, you can see that in terms of technology, smart mobility may be simple. So we are talking about cars and how they are connected and how they can exchange information on the roads. And of course, there's the need for many things. Vehicle technology. So cars, traffic lights, and other devices and facilities related to traffic. There are different hardware. So there are also IoT sensors. And then the communication, after communication, as said just now, nowadays there's autonomous driving. For communication, there is the need for communication technology, for autonomous driving, AI, big data, and so on, AI, all these will get involved. So smart mobility is like a standalone item in smart city, but if you look at the technologies required, they are more or less the same as in other smart city projects. So if you are interested in various technologies in the future when you work, you may be able to contribute to smart mobility. Why is smart mobility important? On this slide, you can see three main pain points. First, traffic congestion. In Hong Kong, there is little land and a lot of people. So traffic congestion affects our lives and reduces our productivity. If there are ways so that cars on the road can be better arranged, then a lot of contribution can be made to society. Number two, traffic accidents. Some are caused by man-made mistakes, some are because of the environment. In a modern place, if we can use technology to enable cars to communicate in a better way, or cars can become smarter, then traffic accidents can be reduced. This is a very big incentive. Now, for Hong Kong, we have little land and many people. Parking is always a headache. So people are thinking of how to better arrange cars in car park. But the precondition is that there must be a good information exchange system. So that's why we need V2X technology. If we have smart mobility technology, so that the roads are safer, there is less traffic congestion, well, there can be also other supporting arrangements. For example, carpooling. And then the traffic arrangements of buses, taxis, minibuses can be better. And there will be less pollution to the environment. Just now, I mentioned a few technologies. In the past years, S3 has been developing these technologies. So communication among vehicles, roadside infrastructure, autonomous driving, and then internet of cars. So connected autonomous vehicles. In other words, if we connect all these together, now we have a rather mature internet of vehicles or connected vehicles. Vehicles can communicate with one another, and vehicles can communicate with traffic lights, and also there's communication with pedestrians that is more mature. S3 has done a lot of things in this area. 5GAA is an international organization specializing in V2X, and S3 is a very active member. And there are different ecosystem companies as our partners. The whole plan will definitely have impact on society. So apart from technology, there's the need for different stakeholders and companies to work together. So just now, soft skills are mentioned. For example, interpersonal skills, communication among businesses, and so on. So even if you study art subjects, you can also contribute to innovation and technology. And in terms of development of V2X technology, Hong Kong is amongst the leaders. Here you can see different countries and cities participating. Apart from laboratory work, we have also done a lot of practical tests. In 2017, we did the first trial in Science Park. There are 5 cases. And in 2018 in Wuxi, we did a large one with 17 use cases. At that time, the outcome was already quite good. We kept on doing more work. In 2019, we did an autonomous vehicle trial in Science Park. So it is where S3 is. This is the most important. At the end of March, we started it. It's a 14-kilometer trial with actual traffic. So from Science Park all the way to Sha Tin Town Center. And there are 19 different use cases. So in the video, you saw them already. And this is a very advanced trial globally. So when it comes to roundabouts, well, it is quite difficult, even for human drivers. When we watch films at home, sometimes if the internet is lower, you will feel uncomfortable. And in the car, you may have to avoid hitting a vehicle or a pedestrian. So the communication requirement is high. Now we have 5G technology for the internet already. And the use of 5G in V2X is very important because we need high effectiveness, low latency, and high reliability in order to achieve good V2X. And then after application of CV2X, well, you may be able to avoid bumping into construction vehicles. And if we know which expressway to take, I think this will help the management of high-speed lanes. And then in the airport, there are special vehicles to transport luggage. These are special purpose vehicles, which can also use CV2X. And then overall traffic management. With a good CV2X, then there will be some new development. Let's say if 2 to 3 tunnels are particularly smooth, so then the toll can be reduced at that time, then more people will be attracted to use those tunnels, then I think traffic will be smoother. These are more recent. In the future, with more development of CV2X and autonomous driving, then there will be connected autonomous vehicles. Then many vehicles can run on the road in a very smart way. And they will be arranged in a very good way. And this is a big contribution to society. So with better technology, what are the merits? Based on our tests and trials, so here are 2 cars, 1 2-seater, 1 10-seater. In the future, more and more vehicles will be added. This test will be completed within this year, and we will communicate with government departments with the data. We hope to expedite the development of smart mobility in Hong Kong. That's all from me today. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Hu. Next, may we invite Mr. Eric Hu, Director of Business Development, IoT Ecosystems, Asia Pacific of Equinix. Now, may we invite Mr. Eric Hu, Director of Business Development, IoT Ecosystems, Asia Pacific of Equinix, to share the topic of smart living. Mr. Hu, please. Good afternoon. I'm happy to have this opportunity to share with you about smart living. My name is Eric Hu. I represent Equinix, Asia Pacific. I work on business development. Just now, many speakers talked about smart city and smart living technologies, and a lot of the technologies are interrelated. So if you refer to the 6 areas, you will see a lot of interconnection and interrelationships. So through this webinar, I hope you will be able to learn a lot. So there can be different information and data among all these areas. Things can be connected so that we can achieve smart living. Let me talk about Equinix. You may not know what our company is doing. Equinix operates data centers. Most people may think that data center is usually in the basement. It is an air conditioned space operated by the companies themselves. And some companies may rent data center operators to keep their infrastructure. Equinix is the world's leader in operating and letting out data center or providing data center service. Our name is rather meaningful. Here you can see equality, neutrality, internet exchange. That means we are carrier neutral. So there are different data for connection. Here you can see some pictures of data centers that are very modern and good looking, and they store different machines. So we hope that different users, users can be carriers, banks, and so on. So users can be connected so that there is internet in the world. So Equinix is one of the large companies working on data center and internet. We have been established for 20 years. At the beginning, different telecommunication companies were connected. If you want to go to a US website to get information, then Hong Kong carrier will have to be connected to the US carrier to get information. So let's say PCCW and AT&T of the US, well, how can they become connected? Then Equinix will connect these two telecommunications companies. So our positioning at the beginning is internet exchange. And then after that, different issues arose. So when carriers are connected, then there is the internet. With the internet, there are different functions. For example, UBS talked about the different trading platforms and digital payment platforms, and those need to be connected. So we also support this ecosystem. And then in the past 5 years, that was the development of cloud. If you need to buy servers, you don't need to buy them really. You can rent them from cloud providers. After that, there is digital ecosystem. This is how Equinix has evolved in the past 20 years. We have different locations. On this map, you can see 220 data centers. We have them all over the world, serving different countries. Here you can see lines, connecting dots, and there are fabrics, servers. So in Hong Kong, we use, for example, Microsoft. And then in Hong Kong, we don't need the internet. You can go direct to Microsoft, then there is privacy. You can enjoy privacy. You may want to use US Microsoft. Yes, this is possible. Then at our location, we offer a line connection to the US. So everything depends on your scenario and your need. So in our positioning, we have 10,000 different customers. We offer different service. There are different servers in our data center. So here, there is global ecosystem. Apart from connecting to different users, there are also different service providers, more than 1,800 network providers and 3,000 cloud and IT service providers. So our positioning is that we offer different interconnections within our data center. You don't need to go or use the public domain. You can already reach your required destination. That's how we support you with our data center. Okay, smart living. Just now, different speakers talked about this. There are different data being captured, and the data has to be analyzed in different facets of life. When you get more data, you will be able to identify a pattern and people's habits. So these are used to enhance your life. That's the idea. Here's an example. Many people are of the view that it is people enabling the data. So I type in something on my handset and then data will be transmitted. But after that, it is mainly machines generating data. They will ask for data and enable data. So from smart home perspective, in the home environment, the machines generate data themselves. After data is generated, then there is comfort, convenience, and control. At different times, for example, you may want a certain temperature, you want the food to be prepared, and safety and prevention can be achieved. On smart home dimension, there is a lot of connectivity. Here on the right, you can see different standards. Well, you may know some names. I think most people know 4G, 5G, and Wi-Fi. However, have you heard about non-spectrum? So no license from the Telecommunications Authority is required for non-spectrum connectivity. Data bit rate is lower. However, people can use very cheap sensors to connect. Sigfox and LoRa are two examples. These are some ways to achieve smart living and interconnections. So you can go to the data center or directly to the cloud with the connection. Assisted living technologies. In Hong Kong, or in many mature economies, aging population is very serious. So we want to help the elderly to live more comfortably. So there can be sensors to detect the condition of the elders. And also, there is more and more data modeling, machine learning, and AI programs to analyze and predict anomalies. So we may need to offer early support for the elders. So these are different areas that can help support people. And then healthcare. Since the outbreak of COVID-19, well, smart healthcare is being given more and more consideration. At home, there can be sensors to sense the patient's condition. And then information can be sent to the physicians. In case of emergencies, alerts can be sent to the physicians to help patients. There can be data analytics and visualization to help healthcare workers. And then population health. So population healthcare planning or EHR can be done. So all these can give us more comfort in life. If we know that there are people who are behind us to support us, then, well, we know that there are physicians and healthcare teams behind us to help, and then we can help Hong Kong to achieve healthcare system planning and optimization. Behind all these, there's the need for data. After data is collected, how can the data be sent to different servers and storage so that things can be integrated and there can be different analytical abilities and multidimensional analysis. I think in the future, this is a big trend. If you are interested in technology, I think healthcare is going to be a very professional sector. In the coming 10 to 20 years, there will be a big need for technology talents in healthcare. Just now, our UBS speaker talked about payments. So cashless society. COVID-19 has actually accentuated the need. So we want less cash so that cash will not become a spreader of virus. So in the past, we used credit cards. Now, very often people store credit cards into their smartphones. And then we have telecommunication carriers, payment platforms. There are more stakeholders coming into this mobile payment ecosystem. We want to achieve cashless and seamless payments. So different ecosystems will emerge as a result. So we hope to achieve connection among different data and points. Just now, Dr. Ho also mentioned traffic flow. Camera can capture road conditions, and ultimately, people want to go faster from point A to point B in a safe way. So apart from traffic congestion, there are a lot of room for enhancement. For example, public transport travel scheduling, traffic lights. Now in Hong Kong, traffic lights are time-based. After several minutes, the signal will be changed. At midnight, the same time limit is being adopted, but then at that time, there is no car really. So perhaps the traffic lights can be operated based on the number of vehicles on the road. So there can be dynamic traffic flow. So in this way, traffic lights can be controlled based on dynamic traffic flow. And when it comes to smart mobility, different technologies can become enablers. With my presentation, I hope that you will have more interest in technology and other related areas. Please feel free to ask our experts questions. Thank you for your time. So now we have got some understanding about all six smart areas. We need to know how they are connected to promote smart city development. So now I would like to invite Ms. Eva Kwok, Director of Talent Cultivation of Hong Kong Community Computer Society, as moderator. Please join me in welcoming the industry partners again for panel discussion on smart city, please. After understanding what each smart area refers to, we should see how they are interrelated and imperative to implement smart city. I would like to invite Ms. Eva Kwok, Director of Talent Cultivation of Hong Kong Computer Society, as the moderator. Please join me in welcoming the industry partners again for our panel discussion on smart city. Ms. Kwok, please. Thank you for the invitation. My name is Eva Kwok, Director of Talent Cultivation of Hong Kong Computer Society. I'm also a partner on risk management of Deloitte. Just now, various guests and speakers have done excellent sharing. I myself have learned a lot. This is a good opportunity for me to have more in-depth exchange with guests, so we can talk about their views about smart city. Without further ado, the first question. Just now, speakers talked about the use of IT to make contribution. I work on IT. However, I haven't thought that so much impact can be created globally. So there can be better living and more impact on the ecology and so on. So many initiatives have been covered. Let's look into the future. Let's imagine 5 years, 10 years, 15 years later, With so many smart city projects and initiatives in the world, what will Hong Kong's future developments be like? I would like to listen to your views. Lucas, can you please start? Lucas, please, can you share your views? I think the development of smart city is indispensable in Hong Kong as well as globally. Hong Kong is more unique because there will be synergy with mainland China. This is going to be a big opportunity. The 14th five-year plan states that there will be a Greater Bay Innovation and Technology Center. And basically, Hong Kong has enough necessary conditions and competitive advantages to develop smart city. In Hong Kong, penetration of smartphones is high. Those above 10 years old, 90% of them have smartphones, 30% or 3% have more than two smart handsets. There are new, for example, smart wallets, and there will be faster development of those. The pandemic has accelerated digital transformation, and the public is now more receptive of remote working, online shopping, and electronic payment. So Hong Kong has good international R&D system, high degree of intellectual property protection, and world-class financial services. And so this is a good opportunity for China. There is a huge market. If Hong Kong develops smart city in this direction, then we are going to be very advanced. ESTRI, in the research of new technology and collaboration with stakeholders, will give a strong push. And we hope that in the coming 5 to 10 years, there will be many good projects coming up. Yes, I agree. Hong Kong is flexible and fast to respond to change. And we have been prosperous in our development. Fred of Microsoft just talked about training. So concerning our future smart city development, what do you think? Thank you, Eva. The Hong Kong government has done a good job. We have Smart City Blueprint 2.0, which outlines the coming smart city projects. If you look at the 2017 blueprint, at that time, there are 76 initiatives, and there are still 30-odd more to go. And there are altogether 140 in version 2.0. So in the coming 5 years, if all 140 initiatives will be fully implemented, then I think the development will be very good. Do we have enough technology talents to cope with all the demands for talents for development of smart city? This is going to be a big worry. If the VDC report is really right, this year there are only 3,000 students studying IT. Now the situation will be unimaginable. So I hope that for talent development, well, there are many initiatives covered by the smart city blueprint. Different departments are working hard. In terms of IT and digital skills, I think it is not about computer science compulsory skills. I think it is as important as language skill. I'm not saying that everybody needs to know programming. Nowadays, programming no longer needs coding. So you don't need hardcore programmers. I think everybody needs to know technology and accept technology. So in smart city development, if everybody doesn't trust technology, doesn't know technology or rejects technology, then we don't think smart city development will be possible. So everything starts from knowledge and understanding. So some people are worried that their information will be taken by others if it is uploaded to the cloud. Well, the more understanding you have, the more trust you have. Without technology and trust, smart city development won't be possible. Now in primary schools, different government departments are implementing many projects. And CLAP Tech Pathway Program has different ways to train our students to cope with future technology and digital transformation demands. Stakeholders need to embrace technology to tie in with development of city. That's most important. Thank you, Fred. Before we move on to the next question, before we offer more tips to students, let me invite Eric. Eric, you just shared a lot of smart living projects. So concerning future development or trust and confidence, what do you have to say to students? Many guests have just said that on the AI level, there is huge need. It's true. No matter whether we are talking about data scientists or patterns for analyzing, when it comes to intelligence, it is not only about the present. We need to look into the future. We need to be forward-looking. So when students consider smart living skills, well, these are required not only in Hong Kong, but globally. I think the whole world needs such talents. You also need to consider more smart city applications. Then you will realize that there are a lot of opportunities for development. So please pay attention to more smart city applications. I do agree. 20 odd years ago, I joined the computer science industry. I was lucky so that I can have good development now. You are all important guests. How should students equip themselves in order to integrate with smart city and other digital and IT developments? Who would like to speak first? I'm Patrick. Let me share first. How can students equip themselves? Actually, last year, there was a smart city report and 100 Hong Kong corporates were interviewed. They were asked, which skills are the most needed in their companies and which are the most difficult to be found? Well, there are three main points. Repeatedly answered by the corporates. First, data analytics. This is most difficult to find. So not only data scientists need to know, all position holders need to know that. They need to know how to handle and understand and make sense out of the data. The second most highly demanded skill set and most difficult to find is problem-solving skill set. Nowadays, in society, there are a number of pain points and challenges. It's quite easy to criticize something. However, how to transform these pain points into future opportunities, that's the skill we need. Number three, creativity and innovation. Not only artists or artsy people need innovation. I think all sectors need innovation, and innovation is a skill. Something may be okay today, but we want to improve it. We want to deliver better customer and user experience. That is where creativity comes in. Some time ago, I interviewed some trainees. I usually posted a curveball and asked questions. A pencil can be used to write, but please tell me 10 other ways how you use a pencil. Okay, students, apart from writing, what can you use a pencil for? That shows how creative you are and how you solve problems and how you analyze. I am Danny from Town Gas. Let me also do some sharing. Many speakers mentioned hard skills, for example, IoT, AI, big data. However, I believe students need to spend time in living experience. I think this is lacking. With more experience in life, you will know what you need to do and how you should develop to enable better development of smart city. In my partner school, Yu Kun Heng Secondary School, they have told me about their activities in school, and I find something very amazing. They will take students to learn diving. Diving is a rather dangerous sport. And if teachers and schools need to shoulder such responsibility, well, I think their goal is to let students understand the pleasure in diving and learn diving skills. Then there may be IoT skills or AI skills, which can help divers to better appreciate the pleasure of diving. So I hope students can feel for themselves how something emerges so that they can accumulate more experience in life. We always talk about big data. Big data is to store living experience and data from the life experience. So I hope that when students are free, please spend more time to get to know things around you. And you need also to develop your own personality and ethics. And there is a course, IP Professionals, with some with elements of integrity, communication skills, and curiosity, and so on. All these can help students to grow. So apart from hard skills, just now many speakers mentioned programming language. And a programming language may fade out a few years, once every few years. And sometimes nowadays we don't even need coding. And speakers also mentioned innovation. So with more innovation, you can shine. I think all these are things that you need to prepare. Very interesting. You mentioned fundamental skills, but you haven't mentioned the type of programming language. I think all those can be learned and adopted. Stanley, fintech includes finance and tech. So what should students pay attention to? In my presentation, I said innovation and technology are important. So in order to succeed, you need passion, because to be technical is a hard skill. Everybody can become technical, but I think it really helps if you are passionate. As Patrick just said, it is important to be innovative. Everybody has creativity. Many students lack self-confidence. They are too shy. They may have a creative idea, but they are not bold enough to share. They are not brave enough to seek help. So sometimes they have good ideas, but the ideas can't come true. The ideas can't be realized. So I always ask students to be brave, to ask questions. They can work with like-minded people, and they can seek verification together. In this way, many ideas can be realized. Soft skills. Okay, you may be very creative. You need to communicate. You need to express your ideas very clearly. You need to be able to seek help. Communication skills are important because you need them to express your ideas. As Danny just said, please pay attention to things around you. Lucas of Astri also said that we can take a look at the broader market. Please do not only limit yourself to a narrow market. Fintech is a global issue. So outside of Hong Kong, there is Greater Bay Area, And actually, outside of Asia, you can go to different places to learn and to work. You can get more understanding of what is happening outside, watch the news, then you have more ideas, and then you can become more creative and innovative. Yes, I agree with you totally. You really have shared a lot of valuable insights. We have talked about different experience. Let me pause here. Let's see whether students have questions. You can make use of the chat box to ask questions. Any questions coming in? Actually, we have overrun a bit because our guests have shared a lot. Stanley said that students should be brave to ask questions. Is there anything you want to know more? There's a question from Lau. Why Blocky still cannot replace normal programming? Blocky is JavaScript language. I don't quite understand what he means. Blocky is JavaScript for websites. So when you say normal programming, what do you mean? Can you elaborate?
Broccoli.
Do you mean Blockly? I think he refers to a new web-based JavaScript development by Google. His question is whether it can replace many other languages. Actually, for each programming, there are different functions. For Blocky or Java, React, Mobile Native, or Data Analytics. So different languages have their own merits. Blocky is a good front-end development, but at the back-end, when it comes to computing or big data analytics, is it the best language? Not necessarily. So if you ask me, there is not one single way for implementation. So if you have passion, you can think of different ways to achieve the same thing. At the end of the day, you have an idea and you can implement it with the best tools. Is Blocky the best way? I don't think so at this moment. It has its merits, but it is not the only way. Let me supplement. Blocky is block-based programming, and the purpose may not be a professional programming tool. So it's like Minecraft and Mickle. Programming tools like those. It is used to train students' computational thinking skill. It is basic computation thinking training, and it is not really a mainstream programming language. For big data, Python, JavaScript, these are more professional options. The goals are different. This programming language is mainly for training students' computational thinking. Thank you for the question and answers. Here's another question. What are the pros and cons of technology in Hong Kong? And how do we complement with mainland China? This is a question from Zhu. So what are the pros and cons of Hong Kong technology? How can we complement and work together with mainland China? Let me share my views. Hong Kong is an international city. So when a technology needs to be implemented, we need to observe international standards. And Hong Kong is a good place to get to understand international standards. Many people may come to Hong Kong. If things can be implemented in Hong Kong, then this is a very attractive point. And for the merit, Hong Kong is an advanced financial center. So there are fewer people studying technology. People are less interested. Every year, I think it's a pity that some young people interested in technology chose to study abroad. So if they can stay in Hong Kong, then there will be more talents in Hong Kong, and that will benefit the whole industry.
Thank you, Lucas.
Thank you, Chu, for the question. Any other points to add by other guests? Okay, then here's one more question. Let me read out the question. What can you say about the development of blockchain and its effects in the present and the future? Development of blockchain, how does it affect now and future? Let me comment. Blockchain is a technology, and its application can be very broad. From a ledger that can't be changed, so that many transactions can be bulletproof. This is important. If you ask me, it's functions. For example, in law, there are a lot of things that can't be changed. In terms of transactions, once a transaction is made, it cannot be changed. So it is a ledger for transactions that can't be changed. It is the original purpose of blockchain. Through blockchain, a lot of centralized information can be transmitted to different places for management together. So legally, there is big room for development. There are a lot of paper-based things in law, and it's time-consuming. So there may be a lot of transactions and procedures that are lengthy and cumbersome. And very often you need to ask an intermediary to get information. That is one bottleneck. And it is one important way in which blockchain can be used. Listed companies and also banks and other production companies use blockchain. Our bank also uses blockchain. Traditional assets are turned into digital assets. This is one broad direction. Apart from that, cryptocurrencies, which is a derivative in investment, is one area as well. These are different ways in which blockchain is used. In the future, can there be blockchain lock, blockchain car key? Yes, all these are possible. As long as there is a near frequency device, then with a distributed ledger, it can prove that the car belongs to you and the car knows that you are its owner, and then the door can be opened. All these are possible. So it is going to be a big strength in the future. Thank you, Stanley. I hope the question is answered. Okay. It's almost time. We are approaching the end of the program. So any final question? If not, then I really feel honored to have this panel discussion with you all. Thank you for your sharing. I hope that all students will remain creative, innovative, and learn to be more technical. Let's be brave in our learning. And then in this way, we can tie in our work with future smart development, smart city development in Hong Kong. Back to the MCs, please. Thank you. The pandemic has changed our daily lives and our industry. So innovative ideas have changed existing service model, and we adopt technology in a broader way to face up to the new normal. Thank you, industry partners and guests, for your sharing. The pandemic has changed our daily lives and business operation modes, by which have brought many insights in taking forward INT development, including transforming the conventional service modes with an innovative mindset and addressing the new normal with wider use of technologies. A great round of applause to all guests and industry partners today that let us understand deeper about smart city and what we can do to drive the smart city development. Next, based on the career interest that you have chosen, you will have 30 minutes of meeting time with various sectors in the breakout room. Please seize the opportunity to learn more. Thank you very much, industry partners and guests. Besides, we are honored to have a few special guests, including Mr. Ralph Sito, Chairman, Hong Kong Association of Interactive Marketing, Ms. Wint Lee from Hong Kong Stammer Limited, and Mr. Anderson Yu, founder of Gamen Noodle Soup. Moving along, we will enter different breakout rooms according to the chosen career interests. Please enjoy the 30 minutes with industry partners, as it is a rare opportunity to know more about each position. We are very grateful to have guest speakers from our industry partners to share with us. Thank you to all of you. Besides, we are honored to have Mr. Ralph Sito, Chairman, Hong Kong Association of Interactive Marketing, Ms. Wint Lee from Hong Kong Stammer Limited, and Mr. Anderson Yu, founder of Game Noodle Soup. Mentors and students, are you ready? When you see the invitation on the screen, you can enter the breakout room. If you have any questions, or if you want to stay here, you may do so. If you have questions, please stay in the chat room, or you can use WhatsApp. Please seize the opportunity. At the end of the event, please complete the questionnaire. The link will be shared on the chat room. Hope to see you again. Goodbye. Are you all ready?